Friends, we are going to revise fetal skull and maternal pelvis today. The diameters which are required in normal labor, in different other positions, malpresentations are quite commonly asked. So let's stress on them. Fetal skull is made up of vault and the base of skull. Vault has compressible bones, basically these flat tabular bones, and base of skull is rigid and it is made up of incompressible bone. So when baby's head goes through the process of labor, in the process of adaptation, mainly the upper portion, the vault, is compressed and the diameter reduces to certain extent, but the base, the basal portion, it is rigid and incompressible, so it doesn't undergo any change. There are important areas again on which MCQs can be asked. What is vertex? What is brow? Face? So let's revise them. Vertex is a quadrangular area. It is bounded anteriorly by bregma and coronal sutures and behind by the lambdoid sutures and laterally by the two lines which passes through parietal eminences. These are two imaginary lines. Brow, it's bounded on one side by the anterior fontanelles and coronal sutures and on the other side by root of nose and supraorbital ridges on either side. Face, area bounded by root of nose and supraorbital ridges and on the one side and junction of floor of mouth with neck on the other. So this is face, above which is brow and then vertex. Sinciput and occiput, occiput behind, sinciput in front. Sutures which are important on the skull are sagittal or the longitudinal, the name or other name of that, coronal sutures, frontal suture and lambdoid sutures. These sutures, they are basically the gaps in between these flat bones and they allow gliding movement during the process of molding. Whenever we do PV examination in labor, these palpation of these fontanelles or these suture lines, they tell us more idea or they tell us that whether the engagement of the head has taken place, what is the degree of internal rotation and what is the degree of molding which has taken place. So it confirms the position and gives us added information about all these parameters. Anterior fontanelle is also called as bregma. Again, MCQ can be asked on this. Posterior fontanelle is called as lambda. Sagittal sutures, they denote the degree of flexion. So if the head is well flexed, then we should be able to feel the posterior fontanelle, not the anterior one. In deflex head, we will be able to feel the anterior fontanelle very easily. Fontanelles, they facilitate molding and helps in later, once the baby is born, it helps to accommodate the brain growth which is going to take place over next 18 months, that the head, the skull will get stretched out, it will accommodate the growing brain inside. If the head would have been formed with fixed bones, then where would that brain would grow in that fixed bone? So that is why they accommodate the growth of brain in the first year of life. Certain important diameters of skull, let's see one by one. In vertex presentation, when there is good flexion, the favorite diameter, that is suboccipitobregmatic, it is 9.5 centimeter. So the smallest one, we all are very happy when the head is completely flexed. In vertex, if there is incomplete flexion, then the diameter would be suboccipitofrontal, 10 centimeters. In vertex, if there is deflection, then occipitofrontal would be there, which measures 11.5 centimeters. On this chart, anytime MCQ can be asked that which would be the diameter in role in brow presentation. In brow, there is partial extension and that is why mentovertical is the diameter which comes in role and that is 14 centimeter. In face, there is incomplete extension and submentovertical or submentobregmatic, that is 9.5, incomplete extension. So these both are face presentation, but these two diameters can be present in case of face. So this chart concisely tells you all the important diameters which are required to remember. In AP diameter, These are the questions asked. Anteroposterior diameter, longest diameter of fetal skull is? And the answer, any guesses? Yes, it is mentovertical, that is 14 centimeters. And what would be the presentation? It is brow. And there is no mechanism of labor in brow. Subvaginal delivery is not possible because pelvis has 11, 12, 13, maximum 13. So 14 cannot pass through this. So mentovertical is seen in brow presentation and treatment would be C-section. Now, transverse diameter of the skull. We have seen anteroposterior. Coming to the transverse diameter. These are again very important. 4 transverse diameter of fetal skull has and questions are asked on this. You have to remember them. Bitemporal, bimastoid, biparietal and super and subparietal. Bimastoid is the smallest one, that is why we have to remember 7.5 centimeters. And bimastoid is the one which cannot get compressed. It is present at the base of the skull. So 7.5 is required. The pelvic diameters, if they are less than 7.5, then they cannot accommodate that particular head. Biparietal diameter is commonly enrolled during the labor and which is 9.5 centimeter. Now, this is a rule here that transverse diameter are smaller than all anteroposterior diameters except biparietal is equal to suboccipital bregmatic. So, whenever you are asked a MCQ and MCQ goes like this that which is the smallest diameter of the fetal skull and the options are given. Then at least you can use this clue that whichever is the transverse diameter that would be the smallest. So you can take this as a clue even though you don't remember exact parameters or exact length of all the diameters. Select the transverse diameter that would be the least or smallest one. Molding. Molding by definition is alteration in the shape of the head when it is passing through the birth canal where the resistance has been offered. Alteration is almost around 4 mm commonly. And usually it compresses, the head gets compressed in engaging diameter and elongation takes place at right angle to it. And this molding usually gets its disappear after the fetal birth. Grades. Usually this molding takes place during the parietal bones tend to overlap all other bones. So parietal ascends on the other bones. What are the grades of molding? If there is little resistance or the pelvis is good, big, there is no compression, much compression effect, then the bones will just touch each other, but there will not be overlapping. So only the fontanelles are getting covered and bones touching each other. In grade 2, there would be overlapping, but it would be easily separable. Like with fingers, you can just push them and they'll move apart. And in grade 3 molding, there would be fixed and more overlapping, which we won't be able to separate it with fingers. So the molding in grade 3 shows fixed overlapping. Again MCQ, smallest diameter of the head, transverse, if it is asked, then it is bimastoid, smallest 7.5. If bimastoid option is not there, then we have to remember bitemporal, the next. Longest diameter, AP, mentovertical is the answer. Brow presentation 14 centimeter. If that option is not there, then we can go for submentovertical or occipitofrontal. Coming to the maternal pelvis. Maternal pelvis has multiple landmarks. You may have a question like this that the pelvic inlet is formed by, and then 5 choices are given, options, and you have to select some out of them. So upper border of symphysis pubis, pubic crest, pubic tubercle, pectineal line, iliopubic eminence, iliopectineal line, sacroiliac articulation, another border, the anterior border of the ala of the sacrum and sacral promontory. And the same thing on the other side completes the pelvic inlet. Pelvis is divided into two, false pelvis and true pelvis. False pelvis is formed by iliac bones and they just support the gravid uterus. True pelvis, it is the canal through which the fetus passes. It is shallow in front, only 4 cm. The pubic symphysis is only 4 cm. And it is deep posteriorly, that is 11.5 cm. This pelvis, we divide it into inlet, cavity and outlet. There are certain features which are present in female pelvis and they are absent in male pelvis. And that makes the whole difference. That is why female pelvis are much more favorable for delivery and male pelvis is not. So features which are narrow in male but broad in female. Again, MCQs are asked on these features, so please concentrate. Greater sciatic notch is very much broad in females, but it is narrow in males. Ischial tuberosity is inverted in males and everted in females. Body of pubis is narrow in males. Subpubic angle is also acute in males. Both the bones, the subpubic angle is acute, narrow. And preauricular sulcus is not very frequently seen in male pelvis, but it's narrow. So there are MCQs and you have to remember these points. Features which are large in male pelvis and small in female pelvis, they are promontory is large in males. Obturator foramen is also large in males. Sacroiliac joint surface and iliopectineal line. First two are more important from MCQ point of view. There is an MCQ, for example, female pelvis as compared to male pelvis has all except, and the options are narrow sciatic notch, shallow and wide symphysis pubis, subpubic angle is acute, light and graceful structure, preauricular sulcus is large. And we all know that female pelvis will have a broader sciatic notch, not a narrow. So the answers are narrow sciatic notch is present in male, not in female, and in males even the subacute angle will be narrow. Coming to pelvic inlet, the shape is round. The plane of the inlet is an imaginary flat surface bounded by the bony point, superior straight it is called as, and accesses the perpendicular line to the plane of the inlet. Inclination, the angle of inclination. This plane, you know the pelvis is this way. So the plane makes an angle with the horizontal and this angle is about 55 degree and this is called as angle of inclination. When the angle increases because of sacralization of the fifth lumbar vertebra, it is called as high inclination, and the significance is it causes delayed engagement, it favors OP position, and there is difficulty in descent of the head due to long birth canal and flat sacrum. It interferes with the internal rotation. Now going to the diameters of the inlet. Anteroposterior, true conjugate, same it can be also called as anatomical conjugate or conjugate vera. It is the distance between midpoint of the sacral promontory to the inner margin of the upper surface, upper border of the pubic symphysis. It measures 11 centimeters. We directly cannot measure it, so we measure the diagonal conjugate, and by subtracting 1.2 centimeter from it, we get the true conjugate. Obstetric conjugate, it is actually important for labor. It is the distance between the midpoint of the sacral promontory to the prominent bony projection in the midline on the inner surface of the pubic symphysis. It is the shortest AP diameter, whatever diameters we have out of which, and it measures 10 centimeter. How do we calculate it? By subtracting almost 2 centimeters from the diagonal conjugate. It is the most important diameter. So if a MCQ is out of these, which is the most important AP diameter of the inlet? The answer would be obstetric conjugate. And the obstetric word is the clue because it is the one which has important role during labor. So remember obstetric conjugate. The most important diameter of inlet, as it is the one through which the fetus must pass. An inlet is considered as narrow or contracted if obstetric conjugate is less than 10 centimeters. Now diagonal conjugate is the one which we measure. It is the distance between the lower border of the pubic symphysis and midpoint of the sacral promontory. So with all aseptic precaution, we pass a hand, try to feel the sacral promontory. If the promontory is not felt, we are happy that the diagonal conjugate is much more. If it is felt, then we just mark the point here and measure this distance, and it's called as diagonal conjugate. It measures 12 cm and clinically measurable. Transverse diameter is 13 and oblique is 12. Now the cavity of the pelvis. It is bounded above by inlet and below by plane of least pelvic dimensions. Please remember this plane of least pelvic and greatest pelvic dimension. The shape of the cavity is round. All the diameters are 12, 12, 12. The plane is plane of greatest pelvic dimension. So the plane of the cavity of the pelvis, it extends from the posterior surface of the symphysis pubis to the junction of the second and third sacral vertebra, and that is called as plane of greatest pelvic dimension. Axis is a mid-perpendicular line drawn to this particular plane. Obstetric outlet, it is a segment between the plane of least pelvic dimension to the anatomical outlet. Shape is oval, the plane is plane of least pelvic dimension. And axis is again the line joining the center of the plane with the sacral promontory. Now let's see this plane of least pelvic dimension, because this is again a favorite question. Extends from the lower border of the symphysis pubis to the tip of ischial spines and posteriorly to meet the tip of fifth sacral vertebra. So it starts from lower border of the symphysis pubis, goes through the ischial spines and then meets posteriorly at the tip of the fifth sacral vertebra. This plane is important for following points. Again, an MCQ can be formed on this. Internal rotation occurs at this particular level. Ischial spines, levator ani, so internal rotation. It marks the beginning of forward curve of the pelvic axis. It also represents zero station of the head. External os is always situated at this particular level. It marks the origin of levator ani. It's a landmark for pudendal block. And most cases, deep transverse arrest, it occurs at this level. So, I hope if it's not asked, this can be a MCQ. Obstetrical outlet, the transverse diameter is the interspinous diameter. That is the distance between two ischial spines and it measures 10 cm. The shortest transverse diameter of the pelvis. Anatomical outlet, bony outlet. Bounded in front by lower border of the symphysis pubis, laterally by the ischiopubic rami, ischial tuberosity, sacrotuberous ligament and posteriorly by tip of coccyx. The shape is diamond shape and plane is the line joining lower border of the symphysis pubis and tip of coccyx. Axis is again perpendicular line to the plane. This posterior sagittal diameter, very favorite. This used to be used before when X-ray used to be the procedure by which pelvic adequacy or pelvimetry was measured. Posterior sagittal diameter is the one which tells us whether the pelvis is adequate for that baby or not. It is the distance between sacrococcygeal joint and the midpoint of the transverse diameter of the outlet. Outlet, the transverse diameter, midpoint of that to the sacrococcygeal joint. Prognosis of vaginal delivery depends on it and it has to be more than 7.5 cm or some books mention 8 cm. So posterior sagittal again is very important diameter and a question can be asked. So we have seen the pelvic and fetal skull diameters. Now let's remember or revise which are the important point. Longest diameter of the pelvis, transverse diameter of the inlet, and AP diameter of the anatomical outlet 13 cm. Shortest interspinous diameter, that is 10 cm. Longest AP diameter of the inlet is diagonal conjugate 12. All the other obstetric conjugate is less than that. Anatomical is less than that. Shortest AP diameter of the inlet, that is obstetric conjugate 10 cm. Critical conjugate. If it is less than that, then the pelvis is considered as contracted or it will have some effect on the fetus. There are other terminologies which are also important. They are the subpubic angle. Subpubic angle is the angle below the pubic symphysis, pubic arch, mid pelvis, pelvic axis, that is anatomical curve of Caris or obstetrical axis, and dynamic pelvis. But these terminologies are not much of importance. Dynamic pelvis, the pelvis is called as dynamic because during labor, all these joints, there can be stretching and there can be by a few millimeters, the diameters can increase when the baby is going through the pelvic cavity. So because of that, it is called as dynamic pelvis. Even the coccyx can get pushed little forward. So the diameters, they get little stretched during labor, and that is why the term uses dynamic pelvis. So this revises the whole topic of maternal skull and maternal pelvis and fetal skull, and it will be surely helpful to you to remember few diameters whenever you revise this topic. Thank you.